Thomas, Todd.
Blessings of life. We thank you for allowing us to be here at your house this morning. Pray that you go with us, be with our song service, and pray that everything's done beat up with your name. And when it comes time, the most important time of the meeting, Lord, when you send your word to us, I just pray that you'd use Steve in a mighty way and just give us the things we stand in need of, and pray that we'd accept it with a willing heart. Lord, help me to be a better Christian. Pray that something I do just help bring somebody to you. Forgive me of my sins. Just pray again that you'd go with us through this meeting. We ask all these things in thy name. Amen.
Page 343, all three verses. Won't it be wonderful there?
Wonderful there.
time the choir comes to sing.
Place. He is here. tasted all the things that sin could think to offer me. But today I feast on manna from
here. Hallelujah. He is here. Amen. He is here. Holy, holy. God bless your heart. I appreciate you being in the house of God today. I appreciate each one of you. I want to ask you to open your Bibles and two different places. I want you to go, first of all, the book of James, chapter number 4, and then 2 Chronicles, chapter number 15. James chapter 4, 2 Chronicles, chapter number 15. If you're able to do so, would you stand for the reading of God's Word this morning? James chapter number 4, I'd like to read verses 8 through 10. The Bible reads like this. It says, "Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and He shall lift you up." The thought this morning is found in the first part of verse number 8, where it says, "Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you." Now over in 2 Chronicles chapter number 15, I'd like to read the first 7 verses. The Bible said, "And the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded. And he went out to meet Asa, and said unto him, Hear ye me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you while you be with Him. And if you seek Him, He will be found of you. But if you forsake Him, He will forsake you. Not for a long season Israel hath been without the true God, and without a teaching priest, and without law. But when they in their trouble did turn unto the Lord God of Israel and sought Him, He was found of them. And in those times there was no peace to him that went out, nor to him that came in. But great vexations were upon all the inhabitants of the countries. And nation was destroyed of nation, and city of city, for God did vex them with all adversity. Be ye strong, therefore, and let not your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded. Now, I want you to think about this. We're approaching, as we've already announced, our revival services begin next Sunday. God's people need revival. You think about the thought. God's people need revival. In the book of James, it says, draw nigh unto God, and He'll draw nigh unto you. God's people need revival. Revival is not a series of meetings. Revival is not an emotional experience. Revival is not turning over a new leaf. Revival is not trying to do better. Revival is not something that somebody else needs. Revival is each individual's responsibility. Revival is a change of attitude. Revival is repentance. Revival is a renewal of faithfulness to God. Revival is a renewed commitment to God's will in each believer's life. That's what revival is. God's people need revival. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come in your presence and we thank you, God, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for loving us and caring for us. Thank you, God, so much for your mercy and grace. And Lord, as we bow in your presence, God, we come before you today and we realize that this is a serious, serious time. And Lord, I pray that we'll be attentive to your word. We'll be attentive to the Holy Spirit. And we'll be obedient to what you'd have us to do. And God, we love you and we thank you for loving us. Lord, we love these people that are gathered here in your house. We love those that are listening by the way of radio. God, we love you and we thank you for loving us. And I pray that you'll take us as the body of Christ and draw us close together and close to you. We pray that you'd be exalted in everything that we undertake to do. God, I pray that every song that we sing will be about you. Lord, I pray that, Lord, every word that we speak would bring honor to you. And God, we pray for revival. I pray for revival at Mount Vernon Baptist Church. I pray for revival in my heart and in my life. God, I pray for revival among homes and families. God, we pray for that renewal, that commitment. God, maybe we've gotten off track or we've gotten off path in our lives. And God, I pray that you direct us back to where we need to be in our relationship with you. And Lord, we love you and we just pray that you'll speak to all of our hearts and God, that we would draw nigh to you because you have promised us that if we would draw nigh to you, that you would draw nigh unto us. Without you, we can do absolutely nothing. We need you. We need your presence. We need your power in this place and in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Study out 2 Chronicles. And if you'll study out 1 and 2 Kings, you study out the Chronicles, you'll find a lot of them are in parallel with one another. They have a lot to say concerning the kings of Israel as well as the kings of Judah. In the last part of 1 Chronicles, we see David's death. King David dies. In the first part of 2 Chronicles, we find where that Solomon reigns. His son, David's son, Solomon reigns in his stead. early in 2 Chronicles, we find that Solomon prayed. He didn't pray for riches. He didn't pray that he would be a mighty individual. He didn't pray for any of those things. But Solomon prayed for wisdom. And you know what? God gave him wisdom. And God gave him riches. And God blessed him in a great and a mighty way. If you'll study out in 2 Chronicles, you'll find David. You'll find as David died in 1 Chronicles. In 2 Chronicles, you'll find Solomon as he reigns. You'll find Rehoboam as he reigns. And Abijah as he reigns. And all the way to Asa. And that's where we're at this morning concerning Asa. You'll find in 2 Chronicles major periods of revival that take place in Judah. And they're covered in details during the reign of several of the kings of Judah. Of Asa in chapters 14 through 16. Of Jehoshaphat in chapters 17 through 20. Of Joash in chapters 23 and 24. Under the reign of Hezekiah, also in chapters 29 through 32. And also during the reign of Josiah in chapters 34 and 35. And you'll find that it's a period of revival that takes place there in Judah during the reign of these individuals. Some of the things is always listed, and you'll find that concerning Asa. If you go back in chapter number 14, look at verse number 2, and it just kind of sums up Asa's reign and Asa's life. It says, "And Asa did that which was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God." Isn't that a great testimony to have? Isn't that a wonderful testimony to be said concerning an individual that he did that which was good and right in the sight of the Lord? That's a wonderful testimony to have. And we want to look this morning at the first seven verses. If nothing changes, we'll come back tonight and we're going to look at some additional verses in this chapter. But for the sake of time, this morning we want to look at these first seven verses and some things that just really pop out at us in these verses. The Bible tells us, look in verse number 1. The Bible tells us, it says, "And the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded." Now I want you to think about this for just a moment. If you go down in verse number 8 of that chapter, it says, "And when Asa heard these words and the prophecy of Oded." And so Oded was a prophet. And we find that here his son comes. His name is Azariah. And he comes to King Asa. And he comes to him with a message. And I want you to notice in verse number 1, it said, "And the Spirit of God came upon Azariah." As we look at that verse, this is not something new that was taking place here in this verse. There's several occasions in the Old Testament where the Bible says, "And the Spirit of God came upon an individual." Othniel, which was Caleb's younger brother. If you go back to Judges chapter 3, verse number 10, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. Zechariah the priest, if you turn over a little later in 2 Chronicles and look in chapter number 24, it says that the Spirit of God came upon him. And so there was nothing new that was taking place here as we see Azariah come to Asa. And it said, "And the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded." Today, the Holy Spirit indwells the believer. You and I, the very split second that we were saved, if you've been born again and saved by God's grace, the very split second that you were saved, God in the person of the Holy Spirit indwells you as a child of God. In the book of Romans, the Bible tells us that if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. If the Holy Spirit does not indwell you, it is a sign that you're not a child of God. You've never been born again. You've never been saved by God's grace. One of my former pastors, and also a former pastor of this church, Opal Brewer, he made this statement one time, and I'll never forget it. He said, you know, these people that go around and say, well, I think I am, I hope I am, I guess I am saved. He said, when you get saved by God's grace, the Holy Spirit indwells you. He said, there's not anything as big as the Holy Spirit moves in and you not know it. You'll know it. So today, the Holy Spirit indwells us as a believer. When we're saved by God's grace, the Holy Spirit indwells us. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 30, the Bible tells us that we're sealed with the Spirit until the day of redemption. Once a person is saved by God's grace, you can never, ever be lost again. The Holy Ghost seals us. And in order for us to be lost again, something bigger than God would have to be able to take that over. But I'm glad today there's nothing bigger than God. Amen. We're sealed permanently until the day of redemption. If you look over in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, Jesus talked about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in chapter number 14. Look in verses 16 and 17. It reads like this. And listen to the Word of God as God's Word. It says, Jesus made this statement. He said, I'll pray the Father, He shall give you another Comforter, that He may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth Him not, neither knoweth Him, but ye know Him, for He dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. The Holy Ghost indwells you as a child of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 19, it says, what, talking about your body, says, what, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? Do you realize that your body is the temple, it's the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit of God indwells you as a child of God. He is in you, He is in you, He is in you as a child of God. He indwells you according to the Word of God. So the Bible said the Spirit of God came upon Azariah the son of Oded. Said He went out in verse number 2, notice. Said He went out to meet Asa, and said unto him, notice this, He said unto him, He went out, the Spirit of God, and came upon Azariah, and He went out to meet Asa the king, and He said unto him. Now I want you to notice, look over in 2 Peter. In 2 Peter, or jot these down, you don't have to turn, but in 2 Peter, chapter number 1, the Bible says this. It says, we in beginning in verse 19, says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. You can take Isaiah, you can take Jeremiah, you can take any of the prophets that God called and God sent and God gave a message. They spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost of God and delivered the message that God had given unto them. And that's exactly what is taking place here in the Scripture in 2 Chronicles chapter 15. In 2 Timothy chapter number 3, verse 16 and 17, it says, all Scripture, from cover to cover, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. All Scripture from cover to cover is given by inspiration of God. From cover to cover, it ought to be taught. From cover to cover, it ought to be preached. From cover to cover, this is the inspired Word of God. It's given by inspiration of God. This Word that you hold in your lap, this Word that I'm reading from this morning, is God-breathed. The Word of God. God's Word. The Bible said that He went out to meet Asa and said unto him, He gave to King Asa what God had given him. He delivered, and was delivering the message. Notice the next thing that happens in verse number 2. It says, He went out to meet Asa and said unto him, Hear ye me, Asa. He encouraged Asa to take heed to what he was hearing. Take heed to the Word of God. Take heed to the message of God. Take heed to what God's Word says. He says, Hear ye me, Asa. He encouraged the king to hear him. Do you know what that Azariah could do as he stood there before the king? You know, my mind went back to Nathan the prophet as he was sent to King David after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba and David had Uriah killed and how that David had everything, thought he had everything covered up. But God sent a little prophet named Nathan down there to King David, and with all the boldness, and all the boldness, Nathan stood there before the king, and he told the king a parable of a man that had a little ewe lamb, and how that a rich man that had all kind of flocks came and took the man's one little ewe lamb and slew it and dressed it and fed a stranger that came by his way. And the Bible said David got angry, and he said, Surely this man shall die. And Nathan, with all of the boldness and the courage at bringing the message that God had given him, stood there before King David and said, Thou art the man. And I can see this. I can see as King Asa is standing there, and Azariah tells him, says, King, he said, listen to this. Hear ye me, Asa. I want you to listen to what I have to say. He spoke boldly. He spoke with courage. He spoke with assurance that he was delivering the message that God had given him. He spoke with the voice of authority because God had given him a message and directed him to bring this unto the king. Makes me think a little bit. Elijah to Ahab, if you go back in 1 Kings chapter, I believe it's chapter number 17. You go back in 1 Kings chapter number 17, and Elijah stood before Ahab and told him, said, it's not going to rain for 3.5 years. Told him that. We think about as Paul stood before Felix. If you go over in the book of Acts chapter number 24, and as he stood there with Felix and began to reason with him the things concerning Christ, and the Bible said that Felix trembled. As he spoke those words, he spoke those words with courage. He spoke those words with boldness. He spoke those words with authority because it was a message from God. I think about the prophets in the Word of God that they're told to go and to be faithful in bringing the message. If you go over to Jeremiah, Jeremiah was known as the weeping prophet. Jeremiah, the people didn't want to hear what Jeremiah had to say. Jeremiah had gotten so discouraged that they put him in jail, and Jeremiah said, well, I'll just keep my mouth shut and I won't say any more. But the Bible said, Jeremiah said, your word was like a fire down in my bones that I could not stay. In other words, he could not keep his mouth shut because of the message that God had given him, and it was burning in his heart and in his soul. You think about this. Be faithful in Jeremiah 23. Verse number 28, listen to what it says. It says, the prophet that hath a dream, let him tell a dream. He that hath my word, let him speak my word faithfully. God has called upon His men. God has called upon His individuals to speak His word faithfully. And that's exactly what was taking place as Azariah stood there before King Asa. He stood there and he was to bring it faithfully, whether they liked it or not. If you go over and look in the book of Ezekiel, chapter number 3, very, very familiar verses of Scripture as Ezekiel was told to go. And listen to this, in verse number 10 and 11, it says, "Moreover, he said unto me, Son of man, all my words that I shall speak unto thee, receive in thy heart, and hear with thine ears, and go get thee to them of the captivity and the children of thy people, and speak unto them, and tell them, thus saith the Lord God." Whether they will hear or whether they will forbear, whether they'll listen or not, you deliver my message and deliver my word. God called on His prophets to be faithful, to deliver the word of God, and to deliver His message. So Asa, the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded. He went out to meet Asa and said unto him, "Hear ye me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin." Notice this. The Bible says this. The Lord, he says, "The Lord is with you while ye be with Him. And if you seek Him, He will be found of you." Think about this. The message declared that God's relation to His people depended on their relation to God. I want to ask you a question this morning. Has God ever been any closer than He is right now? Has God ever been any closer than He is right now? Do you realize this morning we're as close to God as we want to be? We're as close to God as we want to be. Now I know that God in the person of the Holy Spirit indwells us as a child of God. But sometimes we allow things in our lives, we allow events to go on, we allow things to happen in our lives that we're at a distance. I think about Peter a lot of times. That, you know, the Lord told Peter, said, "You're going to deny." You know, Peter said, I'll go with you. I'll die with you. I'll do all of this. And the Lord told him, said, "Peter, you don't know what you're talking about, because before this night's over, you're going to deny that you even knew me three times." And the Bible says, after Jesus' arrest, that Peter followed afar off. I'm afraid a lot of times in our lives that we follow at a distance. We follow at a distance. Azariah said this, said, "Look, in this message that he was delivering to the king, he said, 'The Lord is with you while you be with him. And if you seek him, he will be found of you.'" He'll be right there. It says, "But if you forsake him, you turn away from him, he'll turn away from you." The scripture I read in James chapter 4, verse number 4 says this: "Draw nigh to him, and he'll draw nigh unto us." Draw nigh unto God, and he will draw nigh unto us. The Bible tells us in Colossians 1:27, it says, "Christ in you, the hope of glory." He's in us. He is in us. He indwells us as a result of the new birth. He indwells us by the very fact that we've been born again and saved by God's grace. He has promised to be with His church. He has promised. He gives us a promise that He will be with His church as we go about fulfilling the Great Commission. Now, but I want you to listen to this. You listen to what it says. Matthew chapter 28. The Bible says this in verse 18, beginning verse number 18. It reads like this. It says, "And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, 'All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. To the church, we're to preach the gospel. Converts are to be baptized. And we're to teach them to follow the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're to preach it. When they get saved by God's grace, they're to be baptized as converts, testifying to the world that they've been saved by God's grace. And the church is to teach them, to train them, to allow them to grow spiritually in their lives. That's what the New Testament church is to be doing. And he said this. He said, go teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. That's what we're to do. That's what we're to be doing. And he promised this. And lo, I'm with you always. And I'm going to tell you what, as long as we're fulfilling that great commission, he has promised us that he'll be with us always. That he'll be with us as the New Testament church. Read a history. If you go back and read a history of Israel, when they walked in obedience to the Lord, when they walked in obedience to his word and to his way, he was with them to guide them and to defend them. But when they chose a path of disobedience and they turned away from God, he left them in defeat. He left them in sorrow. He left them to reap exactly what they had sown. Read about the captivity in Babylon. It was a result of their disobedience and rebellion against God. Azariah said, listen, Asa, hear me. The Lord is with you while you be with Him. If you seek Him, He'll be found of you. If you forsake Him, He'll forsake you. Look in verse number 3. It says, now for a long season Israel hath been without the true God, and without a teaching priest, and without law. But when they in their trouble did turn unto the Lord God of Israel and sought Him, He was found of them. Look at verse 5. In those times there's no peace to him that went out, nor to him that came in. But great vexations were upon all the inhabitants of the country. Think about this. Azariah's message told him that when people departed from the Lord, they had no peace. In other words, they had instead vexations. The word vexations means confusion, disturbance, panic, severe turmoil, trouble when they turned away from God. You know who the most miserable person is? Is a child of God that's out of the will of God. The most miserable person is a child of God out of the will of God. He told Asa, said, look, he said, there's no peace to those that went out, to those that came in. There was only vexation were upon all the inhabitants of the country. Azariah's message said, when they departed from the Lord, there was no peace. Next thing, Azariah's message were, there was no divine teaching. Back up in verse number 3. There was no divine teaching. The people became weak and powerless. Said, for a long season, Israel's been without the true God and without a teaching priest and without law. They've been a long season, a long time in that condition. And they had become weak and powerless. Over in the book of Hosea, in the book of Hosea, chapter number 4. Listen to these words. The Bible says, "Hear the word of the Lord, you children of Israel. For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there's no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land. By swearing and lying and killing and stealing and committing adultery, they break out and blood touches blood. Therefore shall the land mourn, and everyone that dwelleth therein shall languish with the beast of the field and with the fowls of heaven. Yea, the fishes of the sea shall also be taken away. Yet let no man strive nor reprove another for thy people, for as they that strive with the priest. Therefore shalt thou fall in the day, and the prophet also shall fall with thee in the night, and I'll destroy thy mother. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee. And thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. And as they were increased, so they sinned against me. Therefore will I change their glory into shame." What a shape. What a shape. Remember, church, remember. Remember the warning that is given to us in 2 Timothy chapter number 4. Paul, writing to Timothy, said this, "I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at His appearing and His kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables." If somebody is trying to preach or teach something that's against this right here, turn away from them. Get away from them. Get away from them. Stand on the Word of God. Preach the Word. Teach it. The Word of God. God's holy and precious Word. Azariah's message also contained the faithfulness of God. Notice in verse number 4. He says, "But when they in their trouble..." You ever been in trouble? You ever had trouble going on? Notice. It says, "But when they in their trouble did turn unto the Lord, God of Israel, and sought Him, He was found of them." When they turned. Repentance is an about face. It's a turning away from and turning to. When they turned to God, guess who was there? God was right there. When we get away from Him and we turn to Him, guess who's going to be right there? He's promised us that He would be right there. Draw nigh unto God, and He will draw nigh unto you. The last thing I want you to think about is this, and it's found in verse number 7. Azariah's message. It says, "Be ye strong therefore, and let not your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded." Azariah's message encouraged Asa to be strong. He encouraged him to keep on keeping on. He encouraged him to remain faithful unto God. He encouraged him to exercise faith. Trust God. Trust Him. Trust God. Exercise faith. Our faith is so important. The Bible tells us the just shall live by faith. Child of God, we're to live by faith. Faith is so important. It's trusting God in every situation, in every circumstance. Trust Him. Trust Him. When we exercise faith in God, it's just like God's storehouse is wide open of those promises. And I'm going to tell you what, He never runs out. He never runs out. There's an abundant supply. When we exercise faith in our lives, it's inviting God to come on the scene. It's out of my hands. God, it's in yours. I'm trusting you. The problem is, we want to hang on to it instead of letting go and letting God. Just let Him. What a message God sent through Azariah to King Asa. What a message. What a great message that He sent of the faithfulness of God. God inspired him. God laid it out there, and he brought that message. He was faithful in bringing that message to King Asa. We're going to see what happens, Lord willing, tonight with King Asa and what takes place and how the people respond. We need revival. We need revival. The Bible tells us in Romans 10:17, "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." You know how we exercise faith? You know what causes us to exercise faith? It's right here. It's God's Word. The Word of God. Man will disappoint you. Man will let you down. Man will fail you. But God's Word never will. Never will. Promise. Let's stand our feet. Bobby, if you'll come. It's time of invitation. I want to invite you to come. If you're here and you've never been saved by God's grace, come. If you're here this morning and God has spoke to your heart, you realize you need revival. Revival is not something that somebody else needs. Revival is every individual's responsibility. It's our responsibility. And I'm going to tell you what, if we really want to experience revival in our lives as an individual, we can experience that. We can experience that. If we want to experience a revival as Mount Vernon Baptist Church, we can experience that if we really want it. If we really want revival. A revival is not our way, it's God's way. It's the bottom line. It's not our way, it's God's way. Let go and just let God. Let God take it. Let God move. Let God do the work. Let Him take care of it. We need to be faithful in what we do. In the message, in the teaching, in our witnessing. We need to be faithful in that. And then leave the results to God. God will take care of the results if we'll be faithful. This altar is open. Invitation's open. If you'd like me to pray with you, I'd be honored to do so. If you want to just come pray yourself, you come. Just be obedient to the Lord as we sing this time of invitation. Bobby, what's your number?
Page 539. 539, "Lord, I'm Coming Home."
on this next verse, we want to open the doors of Mount Vernon Baptist Church for reception of members. If you're here and the Lord has saved you and you'd like to come and unite with this church, a candidate for baptism, we're going to have baptizing next Sunday. You're in our 11 o'clock service. And if you'd like to come unite with this church, a candidate for baptism, we're going to invite you to do so. Also, if you're here and your church membership's at a sister Baptist church and you feel like this is where the Lord have you to move your membership, we're going to invite you to come as well this morning. The doors of Mount Vernon Baptist Church are open at this time for reception of members. So we sing this next verse.
On the 5th.
This is...